Awesome. So we're live on Facebook. Well, thank you for everyone that's joining us today. My name is Nicholas. I'm a sales representative here at Team Rajpal, and I have my coworker here, Carlos. And Nick, we're going to be talking today about landlords and tenants FAQ, like the common questions that we have from our clients, and then we can go through it. Go through it today. So I have a little slide here prepared. Let me just share my screen as well. Can you see my screen, Carlos?
Yes.
Like, can you see the slides?
Yeah.
Okay, awesome. So yeah, so we just prepared, gathered a few questions, and we're just gonna have a discussion today, a nice casual discussion about some common questions from landlords or tenants regarding to leases. If you by chance have any other questions that we are not covering today, I'm going to, at the very end, we're gonna have basically our information. You can email us there or contact us directly regarding that. So let's start with the first question we have. Now, can my landlord evict me if I have a pet? Now, this is a very common question I get a lot from my clients, from a lot of tenants. Now, technically, under the Residential Tenancy Act, the RTA, you can even if you sign a lease that says you're not allowed to have pets, in Section 14 in the RTA, it specifically says that all there is no such thing, it voids all no pet clauses. So even if you have a clause saying no pet, the landlord cannot evict you because of a pet reason. The only time that can happen is if, let's say, you're renting a condominium and they're basically the rules itself in the condo is restricted for not having a certain type of pet or any pets at all, then yes, you can be evicted for that reason. But in general speaking wise, you can't. I mean, like, you can technically, landlords can, there's a little gray area. The landlord can say no to, let's say, having you, no to your application when you're applying for the unit. If you already have a pet, like, they can say no because they preferably they don't want a pet. Then yes, that could be. But let's say you're getting a pet middle way through the lease, or you already have a pet, and the landlord accepts it, they cannot say no to that. Okay. So the next question, and do in mind these answers that I am providing are very general as well. If you want a more detailed or specific type of answer, you can contact us or visit the Landlord Tenancy Board's website for those kind of inquiries. But the next question, if I am a monthly tenant and I don't have a lease, is it all right if I only give 1 month's notice?
Good question.
Yeah, this is a great question. Now, if it's a 1 year lease that you already have in play, or it's month to month, you have to give your landlord 6 days notice. Now, this is common courtesy. You have to give them a 6 days notice in a form as well, either the N9 form that the tenants fill out for the landlord, and on the form itself it clearly says 6 days notice. So if you give a 30-day notice, technically the landlord has the right to keep you for the extra 30 days, and therefore you have to give another month's rent. So you want to be careful with that. If you're on a normal lease term, 6 day notice is mandatory. Okay,
good to know.
Now this one, how much can my rent raise? Now, this can be either for a landlord's perspective or a tenant's perspective. It's nice to know. Every year, the Ontario government publishes a guideline, an annual rental increase guideline. When it comes to rental increase, your landlord, or if you're a landlord, you have to provide your tenant a 90 days notice to increase the rent. So it can only take place with that 90 days notice. And the form you use is called the N1 form. You can Google these forms that I'm telling you about, and it'll just pop up on the first search. And on the form itself, it even has a more detailed explanation of any restrictions of rent increase, or the notice as well, the 90-day notice on there. So this year, with COVID and everything happening, 2021's rent increase is frozen. Therefore, you cannot increase the rent. And last year in 2020 was 2.2. So there is some restrictions. Now, there is no rent control for units that are built after November 15th of 2018. So there's, if you're buying a new construction and a pre-construction that was built after that, there is no rent control for those. So technically you can jump from $1,000 to $3,000 if you bought those type of buildings.
Even with these COVID restrictions, Nick?
Yeah, because there is no rent control with these, so you can't increase it. Yeah.
Perfect.
So what happens if I don't renew my lease? So if you don't renew your lease, you would actually automatically be on a month-to-month basis with the tenant or your landlord with the same terms and conditions of your current lease. It's exactly the same. It's just that there's no fixed period. You still need to give a 60 days notice. And typically what happens is 60 days before, rephrase that. Before 60 days before your one year lease is over, you should let your tenant know if you're continuing, your landlord or your tenant, to know if they're continuing or not. If they are continuing and they don't want to sign a year lease, which has been mutual, it'll become month to month. And then therefore the tenant will have to give the landlord 60 days notice during that month-to-month period if they want to leave or not. Either way, there'll be a 60 days notice. So so this is very important to know. If nothing is done, it's just automatic assume it's month-to-month if the tenant's continuing. Okay. So how should I qualify tenant? Well, I'll let Carlos deal with this because he's been working with a lot of our tenants as well.
Thanks, Carlos, Nick.
Elaborate on this.
Absolutely. Well, there are different ways to qualify a tenant. Most of landlords, they look for a healthy rent versus income ratio of a 30%. So what that means is for every $300 a tenant will spend on rent, the landlord would expect them to make $1,000. So not spending more than 30% of their net income in rent, that would be a very healthy way. Absolutely, credit reports, Nick. Credit reports or credit history not just will show a score, but also credit behavior. If there's any outstanding noticeable debt, will show there. As well as having a stable job, a good reference. And one of the most important things that landlords look for is a good referral from their current landlord. So having complete that due diligence, reference checks or employment verification, but also speaking to that current landlord would be a great way to qualify a tenant. And having an interview between the landlord, the prospect tenant, and that way they have the opportunity to see if it's a good fit for both of them.
Yes, no, those are really good tips. And what we're talking about is basically a AAA tenant. You know,
absolutely.
And that's a perfect world. Not all tenants are AAA. And don't get me wrong, I have quite a few rental properties myself, and they're not always AAA. Meaning that maybe they have good income, but it's a new job, it's a new career. And sometimes if I'm interviewing the tenant and, you know, we get that connection, I feel like they're going to take care of the place, I'm willing to give that, that chance to them. Now, this is all personal preference. I'm not saying you should do it or you should not do it, but you know, you have to be realistic. I mean, like, you're not all the tenants you're going to get is going to be that AAA tenant. There's bound to be something that you have to be more flexible on. Let's put it that way. But yeah, I mean, like Carlos, I'm pretty sure we work with a couple of tenants that we're talking about that are maybe almost AAA tenants, but not quite there yet. And, you know, we found landlords are perfectly happy with them, right? So,
and given the circumstances as well, Nick, current situation with COVID or the lockdowns or whatnot, but living in a country full of immigration, but there's a constant flow of people coming in, And most of landlords, you know, would just look for that good behavior. I've seen landlords even ask for a credit report from their home country. So that way we'll see if that immigrant is coming in and going to behave the same way as they're in their home countries, right?
Exactly. Yeah. No, those are good points. So let's go to the next question. So, Carlos, you want to take this one as well?
Absolutely. I love this one. I agreed to take my rental as is, but I never realized how bad it was. Does that mean I have to pay for the repairs, or does the landlord still have to fix up the place? Great question. So even if you're aware that the apartment is in need of repairs, when you agree to rent it, the landlord will still be responsible for taking of the repairs and the maintenance. Sometimes I've seen clauses that would specify, you know, a certain amount, anything over $100 or anything over $200. But if you did do the repairs, you can apply for the board for compensation if there's no specific clause that will refrain for that. You know, usually when you're leasing a house, the repairs, you know, would sometimes would be more costly than just, you know, living in a condominium where the living space is completely different. So having said that, it is the responsibility of the landlord to keep the household in a safe environment. And, you know, that includes utilities, appliances, anything in working condition for the enjoyment of the tenant. It's kind of like a give and take relationship. So the tenant pays for the rent and the landlord keeps the place up to par.
Mm-hmm. I mean, like, the landlord's responsible for anything that's normal wear and tears. Of course, if the tenant, due to negligence, purposely breaks something, but due to
absolutely,
the tenant is fully responsible for those payments. So, just want to be careful with that. But you know, it is the landlord's responsibility to maintain the place for you. Any major repairs, like not say light bulbs or anything like that, but major repairs or appliances, to make sure you have a good living experience starting from and ending when you leave the place as well.
And I like what you said, you know, respecting that place as if it was your own, and then building that relationship with the landlord. I think it's crucial.
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, like, a landlord wants someone that just takes care of the place and pays the rent on time. Tenant just wants a place that's in good condition and having a landlord maintain the place, right? So as well, if anything. Yeah. So it's a good push-pull relationship. It should be healthy as well.
I agree.
That's why I think an interview is very important for like face-to-face. So you know who's living there. And then for a tenant, you know who's taking care of the place on the backside. Right. So
I've done actually in the last couple of weeks, I've done actually a couple of Zoom interviews because given the circumstances, we can meet face to face. We'll just get the interview going on Zoom or on WhatsApp video. I mean, so many ways we can do that nowadays. Right.
Yeah. So that's a great one. A great question right here. Some of these questions I did get as well from the TorontoTenants.org, which is a form for a website for tenants. If you're having a bad experience or just want more information too, by all means, go on there as well. You'll find some more even questions on there they have, and they'll definitely help you out. It's a great website as well. Well, the next, can the landlord enter my apartment even when I'm not home? So technically, the law says the landlord may enter your apartment if you're not home for the certain reasons. So one is inspection. Given within a mutual, like a 24-hour notice, they can come into your home just to do a casual inspection. Another one would be repairs can be done, given another 24-hour notice. A next one is if you're given notice to a landlord and the landlord has given you a noticeable, so basically to show a new tenant. If basically they give you notice and saying that they're looking to lease out the place, and then give you enough time, they can come in and show the place, or even have the representative, a licensed realtor, to do so. And lastly, emergency, you know, knock on wood, but gas leak or anything like that, a flood, and you're not home, they have every right to come in to assess the situation. And here we have is Next one is, how can I break my lease? So this applies, I guess, for a landlord or a tenant. If for some reason a landlord wants to end the lease earlier, or another reason why a tenant wants to leave the place earlier. The best way to do it is a mutual agreement. I mean, like having a landlord and a tenant come to agreement of, you know, for some certain reason, they want to terminate. I think that's the best form. Keep everything kosher. And make sure you use legal documents to do so. So for termination, for let's say early termination, N11 form, once again, on that form, Google it. I'll have the details on there. And you can, I'll have the landlord and the tenant sign it. So making sure that both parties are agreeing to that. If the tenant wants to end the termination by themselves with that 60 notice, they use an N9 form. So, but that's completely different. For this specific case, you want to use an N11 for both parties to sign. Another way is, I would say, call the landlord tenant board. If it's a very specific situation, you can call the landlord tenant board, have them assess the situation and give you the next step forward. If there's a certain situation, let's say, health concern or safety concern, that kind of subject or situation, I would just speak with the board for that. But if another way is if you can have another tenant replace you. So typically speaking wise, if you want to end a lease early, and the landlord's not willing to break the lease, you have the right to, I guess, sublet the lease or have someone replace you directly with the landlord's consent as well. But you can get that. You can get help with that as well through the torontotenants.org, the website I just talked to you about. They have a hotline on there as well. They'll give you more details or give us a call too. We always have tenants looking. And maybe we can get someone to replace you if you need to move out of the place. So I think that's all the questions. Yep, that's all the questions we have. If there's more questions, feel free to email us here. Our phone number is at the below. Lastly, I included the landlord tenant board's phone number and the email. Give them a shout too if there's something that's beyond our capabilities. They can definitely help you out. But generally speaking, if you don't, if you just want a quick answer, give us a shout. We can provide you more further details. But Carlos, do you have anything to add, or that's good on your side as well?
Thank you so much. Great information, Nick. And as you said, feel free to reach out, comment below, like us on Facebook. We're here to help you. Have a great day, everybody.
Perfect. See you guys next week.
Yeah.